Fort CASSO is probably one of the most impressive places I have ever been, where I've met some of the most impressive historians I have ever met. If you truly want to understand how the Maginot Line worked, this is where you start.
How long is this?
Just amazing the damage this thing took. I think we have a machine gun and a grazing shot from something much bigger. And of course, water for Centaur. Look at the damage this. And electricity ran up to this, whatever it is.
In these small towns, I am betting you they have not changed.
And 1,200 meters, we will be crossing into France, I just noticed. So we're not far from where the Germans would have crossed the border in 1940. And I'm very curious to see exactly what the French had built for all that time and spent an enormous amount of money building these huge forts.
5 kilometers past the border this direction, and here passing the roadway, we see the first sign of the Maginot Line, which is a good little pillbox with 2 machine gun firing slits and one thing larger that I assume is probably an anti-tank. There's support from the back as well. That's actually kind of neat. It's neat. And the, ooh, there's 2. I wonder if there's one more up here. There's firing ports in every direction. There is. There is literally a firing position in every direction of this thing. Here by the entrance, there would have been a rather large door that does not appear to have been that well armored. This is just a very simple pillbox with firing positions in every direction. All right, so there would have been a heavier weapon positioned here, hatched for rear defense by the door. So this is the first sign I've seen of defense of France. Little pillbox at this road junction.
After World War I, France began to plan a vast fortress and bunker line facing Germany. It turned into the most impressive military construction ever, yet only 5% of 5 billion francs of the French military budget was spent over 8 years in the 1930s. It was extremely well planned and designed, as we shall see. In the 1940s, the Maginot Line forts were built and ready for war. There was a fort of some size for every kilometer of border, all with supporting and interlocking fields of fire. We are at Fort CASSO, Ouvrage d'Infanterie de la Ligue Maginot. Built in 1938, it was armed with 32 automatic weapons and 8 anti-tank cannons, 25 and 47 millimeter and 30 centimeters thick steel cupolas. Some of the damage at this fort was German weapons testing after the battle. Now remember the Czech forts that were built as newer, more modern Maginot Line versions? Germans had occupied them previously, so they knew how to attack from the back when it was possible. In 1940, when the Germans attacked, there were 2 major preparatory German attacks, and they were unsuccessful. They were stopped by the area's various forts, artillery forts, and CASSO held out, all the way up until after France surrendered and they were ordered by the government to pack it up and go home. It was again Fort 4 in 1944 when the area was occupied by Germans fighting the American advance. This is a second generation Maginot Line fort, smaller with 3 separate forts all supporting one another with underground tunnels 25 to 30 meters deep.
This is the first time I actually visit this part of the Maginot Line. And my first impression is there's a lot in a very small space. And if this is indicative of how clustered and densely packed the forts at the Maginot Line was,
I understand why the Germans decided to attack somewhere else.
We have a triangle right here where they can provide mutual support in direction Germany. Dual machine guns, and you have the moat has definitely taken some damage. This damage has come from almost from the rear.
The original name, the Rohrbach, and the name for CASSO, it's today the name of the Association of Volunteers, a small group of men, and we choose the name of a lieutenant, chief of the engineers troop in the place of Rohrbach in 1940. And we choose his name because during peacetime he meet a young lady in the village of Rohrbach. This is the romantic side of the history. And he continues his military careers after the Second World War to be general of the firemen in Paris on the 60s. During the war, he escaped from German prisoners, go to south of France, active a resistance group, taken by the German in 42, and he moved in North Africa from Spain to be re-engaged in the Free French Forces, continues the war in North Africa, afterwards in Italia, south of France, in Alsace and Germany.
This looks original.
Yes, but not this electrical command.
Okay. What is this, two centimeters?
We are here on the second floor of the block. In the fortress there is 176 soldiers and 40 in this block. 40 men with three groups, and every 8 hours the group turn. 8 hours service, 8 hours reserve, 8 hours sleeping. There is one bed for three guys. Three groups on the block and another group on the underground barracks 24 hours.
There is an armored door to the bathroom.
There is a reason. The overpressure. If you have overpressure inside the block,
there has to be an armored door in the bathroom.
There's a reason for everything.
Yes, there is.
Ventilation system with filters with active coals against the gas, and filters with papers against the paper.
Yeah.
Against dust. Yeah. Only used in case of trouble.
Yeah.
Electricity comes normally from the outside, and there is underground generators.
So if you really want to visit the place, you've got to visit the place where these guys have done such a great job of making everything work. That is impressive.
To test the quality of the air, there is different kind of material, papers, if the colors change, there is gas. They use observers after bombing, bird in cage. Sergeant, bedroom, NCO, yeah,
right? That's important.
Has the soldiers, but with more place and...
And the pipes for the air?
Yes.
For the little air vents? People always laugh at me when I call it air condition, but...
I don't know why I love big heavy doors. In case of gas detection, there is a gas alarm. All of the gas alert was connected inside the place, on the free block, on the underground gallery. If the gas was detected on the block 2, on the entry, they give the alarm in all the place in the same time. We move up on the fight post, and after we go down to the gallery.
So... Hell, this is deeper than I thought.
30 meters. This material was an hand grenade launcher to drop the grenade on the mold. They want to use, if there is enemy on the mold, they don't use the grenade with the hand. It's too dangerous inside.
Yeah.
With stress, the grenade fall. Oops, we have problem.
Big oops.
They use this. There is here's the place.
Come on to your right.
There is here's the place for the spoon and a small hole for the ring.
Oh, so you
take the ring, the spoon stay in position inside. You have time.
And not until it's out in the
tunnel. And after, close and push. And you use grenade save.
That is very, very neat. That is very well thought through. And it is very well thought through because yes. Somebody in an office would go like, no, they can just drop it in.
Yes. Well, because if you have to use grenade, you have enemy on the mode. You have bomb explodes, you have stress.
You have shit going
grenade,
on.
Grenade in stress, it's not good, friends. Here's in exposition, the French automatic rifle 24-29, using on the Maginot line for the defense at short distance. That was weapon of observation, cupola, and in some war. We can see the pipes for to collect.
So they literally the funneled the shells. That's again very well thought through. Didn't see that in the German or the Czech ports at all.
In the German, the shell fall directly on the floor.
Yeah,
that's a big problem.
And that's why you have the three holes
and,
for the.
Here with automatic rifle, you don't have the same capacity of shoot in the minutes, but with machine gun,
yeah,
you have more shoot and shell is heat, gas.
Everywhere.
It's always a problem. Officers, the chief of the block.
So what rank would he have been?
Lieutenant.
Oh, okay.
To command the 40 soldiers of the block. And here's it's a small fire post.
So this is the outside casemate.
Yes, yes. Shoot on the direction of the block one.
Yeah.
With a twin machine gun, two machine guns, scope and round magazine. Probably here's a small anti-tank cannon. It's possible to switch machine gun and cannon. And here's the wheel for the automatic rifle. Position for the weapon, and here's to look outside.
So you literally look over the rifle barrel.
And it's in case of bombing or shoot against, possible to close. And no shrapnel come in and...
Very good, okay.
The Maginot line was really astute.
Yeah.
They start construction in the 30s, but they start to think about the construction in the 20s. There is 9 years of reflection to study where we built, what kind of material, and that was built with experience of the First World War, very close.
About a meter thick steel?
Steel concrete and a steel protection against concrete shrapnel with Hopkinson effect.
Yeah.
To block the concrete, no dust falling, no pieces of concrete against wounded and for safety feeling too.
Of course. Yeah, you have to. And this is another grenade
launcher.
This is not bad at all. I have no idea how they help.
No way it's picked up. I'm still impressed.
We have here the anti-tank cannon 37 millimeters, possible to change with the twin machine gun a fixed twin machine gun. We call this a twin because there is two machine gun model 31, one scope and two round magazine. Called normally drum.
So you install the drum. Yeah. Oh, okay.
But in French we have another name given by the French soldiers.
Yes.
Camembert. And for the twin, there is two men, one shooters and one loaders. Shooters put this on shoulder to give direction and
very
distance.
Too.
Yes. Nobody of the church? No. They don't shoot with the two machine gun together, but one by one.
When
the drum is empty, use the second and you have time for the loaders to reload and coating the barrel.
Oh, okay.
And you have a continuous shoot.
That makes so much more sense.
And all of the shell outside on the mold.
That's the same.
The same.
That would then interact with the cannon.
To change with the cannon.
What was that? That was
47 millimeters. The barrel is not clean inside. I'm sorry. There is a dead bird inside.
There's a dead bird inside?
Yes.
Holy shit, there's a dead bird inside. I thought you were kidding. Well, you almost can't tell.
How did the dead bird get inside? Is that a problem for the? Did it live there and then couldn't get out, or?
I don't know.
Did somebody try to fire at it, or?
For the cannon, there is three men. The shooters with the command, here's the first loaders and the second to give the munitions from the loaders to the first and close and ready to shoot. It's a semi-automatic cannon, open, shell full, outside.
And again, we're back to that. Oh, you done. And then that's what, and that would never get stuck. It wouldn't be stuck. That is such an impressive detail.
On the lockers, three and we shoot, and after the first shoot, they let always three, four blades open. The doors of the steel box seen outside for spotlight.
Oh, that's what that is.
Yes.
Okay.
They open here, and the observers in his cupola have electrical command to move the spotlight. There is electrical heaters on the fight post. Mm-hmm. First for material, not for the men. The grease stay fluid.
Yeah.
And better to conserve the ammunition, bombers, these kind of things.
Yeah.
With dry, warm.
Yeah. Keep your powder dry.
Yes.
And warm, but not too warm.
18 degrees.
Yes, like not over 100. Warm, but not too warm. And you had telephone communication throughout.
Yes.
Which is something that if Gamelin had used telephones more, the battle would have gone better.
Gamelin, the commanders, and the General George, the command on the field, there is a lot of trouble between the two.
Yeah.
This is the observation cupola. With a wood floor, the observers move on the floor, and with a chain system, the floor moves up on the cupola. And there is normally inside, there is normally optic, light machine gun, periscope, command for the spotlight.
So there's what room for two or three machine guns out there? Or would there just be one?
No, only one. It's possible to switch, to change the position. Generally they stay in position because the observation cupola was the eyes.
That's true.
And that was the eyes of the place and the eyes for the neighbors.
So that's the double, that's double shelled.
Yes, double. Yes.
So you could actually, so the inner wouldn't ring as bad.
When the observers of the block of the entry, they are shoot by anti-tank cannon, they say nothing. It's just some noise.
Insulated by rubber or?
I don't know.
You haven't taken it apart?
In communication with the command post, with the artillery of the other place to give information and correction of the observer.
So he observes and this is all the communication between. So you have links to all the other, to this fort and then outside?
With underground cable at 4 meters underground.
Yes.
The telephone works with a battery system and still works in case of electrical trouble. There is two batteries inside with normally a circle of zinc.
Yeah.
Zn, yes, uh-huh. Zinc.
Zinc.
And a salty liquid to create an electrical reaction.
Just like the Egyptians, yes. Or the Sumerians had the. Yeah. And this is for air.
Yes.
For emergency.
This, ventilation of the cupola.
Okay.
And when they shoot inside the cupola, same things. Shell fall here and to the basket. This turret is the smallest model built for the Maginot Line. Model 35 with two machine gun and modified to have one light anti-tank cannon. Smallest model, just 96 tons. The biggest, 200 tons. Sometimes small.
I love that you say this is small because this is really not small. This is actually pretty damn impressive.
And we call this eclipse turret because the turret move up to shoot, turn and close. Eclipse. For the Maginot Line, there is 5 models of turrets developed with machine gun, with mixed weapon, with mortar.
AV mortars and with artillery cannon.
Holy shit.
The turret works with electrical system or with the hand. 7 men with electrical system and 12 with handing command.
So what is everything? I mean, I'm looking at this and like this.
We have here the arm of the mechanical system. On the back side, a counterweight, and here's the mobile part. The mobile part move up to shoot.
About a meter up?
80 centimeters.
About,
this part here.
So that's what it is. So the counterweight moves, okay.
There's two men here to load the camembert.
Oh, yeah. Hand loading.
With the system, and here's the elevators to move ammunition up.
And then you had the cannon as well. You had cannon ammunition going up. You had a cannon up as well?
A machine gun and cannon, yes, normally upstairs. The turret works with 7 guys, 2 soldiers in this side to prepare ammunition, 1 mechanicers to look if everything works well in case of trouble, 2 soldiers upstairs to send the munition on the fight post and to coding the weapon, and inside the fight post the chief of the turret, shooters and the loaders. The chief of the turret have a lot of things to do. He sits in a small chair. He has an ending command to move up and down, foot pedal to give direction, an optic in Z to see his target with machine gun on the head and cannon here, and 2 handing wheel to give direction of the weapon. He has another guy on the back to load. With the foot he gives direction, with the hand precision, and shoot with machine gun. When he moves his turret up, it's only with orders. The observation cupola sees some things, give information to command post analyze, and after send the orders on the turret. Now demonstration. I open the security of the counterweight. Here's I hope everything works well. There is camera today, I don't know.
Locked.
Locked, and now motors. And if we push the pedal, but we don't shoot them. If you want to move up, get your jacket here.
If I want to go. If. He said if. Clearly we just met.
Cramped place I've been in my life.
This is not bad. I mean, all right, so he had to work the pedals.
Yes.
He had to work the knobs and the shifts.
This is the right direction and distance. The scope is probably broken, no?
Yeah, I think there's a dead bird in it.
Numbers around, graduation, and on the time there is here painting of the panorama on the outside.
Really?
Yes. The munition comes here.
Drums come, that's right.
The drums. Yeah, there are, yeah. 30 centimeters steel, here and on the ceiling. the time you come.
And this is the inside, and that's the outside.
This is outside. Here we are outside. Here we are on the concrete.
This is really impressive. If I push the pedal.
Of the turret here is not finished. We just have start makes a small lifting.
You just need the painting, then you're good.
Yes. And a lot of things to do. Some here there is normally another light.
I don't feel vulnerable, I don't feel uncomfortable. No.
That's exactly what the chief of the turret say when we meet this guy in the 90s. He say, I heard the history of my father, of my uncle on the trench, and he's saying, here's, I know I'm safe.
Yeah, and he was fighting from here when the Germans were here. I didn't want to miss this.
We have another model of turret, little bit bigger but older, a turret of the First World War.
Really?
Not installed but and stay in reserve. Not installed when the First World War starts, and when there is economical problem for the construction of the Maginot Line, they remember we have 12 old turrets we can perhaps do something with.
And so they had bunkered fort turrets already from World War I.
Yeah.
Where were they at? They were used.
In the fortress of Verdun, Verdun, there is a turret, but only with handing system at the time. The difference with the Maginot turret, same things, but with electrical motors.
Thinking about World War I as being a trench, dirty war, and there was so much technology.
Mm-hmm. André Maginot was the French war minister.
Yes, he was.
And he vote the credit for the construction of the line.
Tom Gunn.
And this man, Paul Painlevé, was the ministers, defense ministers, at the moment of the first meeting to tell what we do with the new borders. This is, in the fact, the two father of the line. We need to go down 165 steps to go 30 meters deep. It was built at 25 to 30 meters deep to be safe in case of bombing on the outside, and for question of money too. On if you build at 25, 30 meters in this time, you don't need steel concrete, and they use masonry, and it's not so expensive as underground steel concrete. The transformers from the 50s. The Maginot Line was reused for a short time on the first part of the Cold War. Here we are at the deepest part with the drain, the evacuation for the waters of the showers, bathroom, toilets.
Yeah.
150 meters, the drain moved to the rivers, the rivers to another rivers, and the other rivers.
Other rivers.
To Germany.
To Germany. So you flooded the drains out to Germany.
At 7 kilometers, we have no sea.
Lights.
Oh. And if you want to look, it's an emergency rescue.
And these are about the size of doors that would have been on the outside moat.
No, a little bit bigger.
Well, I'm not very tall this week. I now have. And again, under pressure. Love it. So this would have been emergency exit as well?
Yes.
How long is this?
150.
Some others, some diggers.
I knew the Maginot Line was going to be impressive. I was impressed by the East Wall. I really was. But, and this is just one out of many forts. And what really impresses me is how this has been restored. This is so cool.
Here's in exposition the 75 millimeter shells using by artillery fortress to cover the infantry fortress built around. This is not a real heavy calibers, but enough to make damage at the enemy.
True.
And not enough to make damage at the block in case of friendly shoot.
Right, right. So there was ammunition transportation down here.
In the small infantry place as ROHRBACH, they're using hand wagon. On the big artillery place, that looks like metro with electric train inside. Here's the small construction. Biggest, 3-4 times like this, with electric train inside. The gallery was built in the chalkstone here, 50 centimeters for the wall, a round ceiling to absorb the pressure, and a round floor to close easily the gallery.
A round floor, or so?
Like this.
Also, it curved upwards.
Curved, yes. And all the washers move to the drain.
Also, oh, there's drainage underneath.
And the drain to each 60 meters, there is cross place. If two wagons arrive, one you can have a cross place. Yeah.
Yep, makes sense.
When you see the cable move up, this is extra cable reserve. If the cable was cut, you have always extra cable for fast reparation. If you are besieged, nothing's come.
Of course not.
You have your reserve.
So that's just, you just built in the reserve. That was, well, very well thought out.
The specificity of this gallery is the stucco on the wall.
I didn't notice.
On the other place, plate wall. The problem with the plate wall, it's very noisy, lot of echo. And they try to do some things. They use stucco to try to absorb the echo, the reverb. And they want to see if the stucco is better for the morale of the soldiers. Not plate, not lonely, has long wall in concrete. We are not sure 100% about this room. That can be an officer's bedroom because we can see the trace here of a decoration of officer's bedroom. Yeah? Here's?
Yes.
Or that can be, in French military world, a foyer. A foyer. It's a bistro, a bar. We have fine pictures not about here, but about other fortification, other fort, where there is bar inside. And we have heard history of a veteran of this place speak about the bar of the place, but we don't know where. It's probably here, but we are not sure at 100%. And we are on the cross between the three blocks. Yeah, yeah. 110 meters in this direction, 265 to the block one, and 220 to the entry. The cross was called the chapel, the church. Every Sunday there is here a Catholic mass for the soldiers. The lieutenant of the entry was the preacher, and when he speak loud,
he would stand here and preach to the troops.
And the man on the gallery. And after, go to the bar.
As you should, as you leave the church.
There is two places like this, one at 4 and another one at 8 kilometers. But they are completely scrapped and destroyed. All the cable was taken and all the material disappear and...
Yeah, that happened a lot.
Now we continue on the direction of a bedroom, a munition, and the barracks.
And it keeps going.
And the barracks was built higher with the munition. It's for the wagon and the drain of the waters.
I notice we're going uphill a little bit.
The drain
move to the block 3 and the wagon with ammunition and food for the soldiers of the block come back empty. And a typical bedroom of the last construction of the Maginot Line. Bedroom with hearts. On the others, there is always bed. But with the bed, you have no living place on the journey. Mm. With the hammocks, it's possible to switch the hammocks, open table, and to have a right place to live. And here, there is a very high ceiling. During the construction, there is here a duty well using to carry the big material. Generators, kitchen, oil, water tank, diesel tank, everything come here in pieces from the outside.
Is that light? Or is that outside? That's a light, right?
No, that's just the light.
I figured it's about
the light. Yeah, no. It's 27 meters the outside.
Did I mention how impressed I was yet? Just want to make sure that I mentioned that.
Natalie, the project when they start the construction was for 4 blocks, but they don't continue this gallery. This plaque here is in memory of the first president of the association, Joseph Koch, one of the first volunteers, and with some friends in 1980, when the First World War started, that was the first French deputy to leave his political post and to be volunteers at 40 years old to be re-engaged in the army. And there is no many political men used this way.
No, there's not.
And the saddest thing about Maginot was he didn't even live long enough to see his complete fortress completed. Or even, he almost hadn't begun to build it by the time he passed.
Left and right, ammunition. And this one change in showroom, museum, where we can see some weapons and material.
So that's the double.
Yes, the twin machine gun.
That's a nice way of seeing it, yeah. What is this, 7.62x39? What is this?
The calibers?
Yeah.
7.5.
That's the same as in the tanks. In the Charlie machine gun, yeah.
The French used 8mm in the First World War and change in 7.5. Rifle more than 36, automatic rifle 24-10-29. These two weapons still works in the French army to the 60s.
Really?
Yeah. And the light anti-tank cannon 25mm. It's a small calibers, but he can shoot at against 4 centimeters steel at 800 meters.
That's still a Panzer 1, Panzer 2.
Panzer 3. First model of Panzer 4. A 4 centimeter steel.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here, this is the machine gun Hotchkiss model 14, using on the small pillbox around the Maginot Line. With the AP fortress, there is a lot of small pillbox for the outside troop.
That is, yeah.
Inside the Maginot Line, fortress company from fortress regiment, and on the outside, infantry troop around. Optic from observation cupola.
That's got. Oh, so yeah, so this would go all the way through the wall.
Yes.
And then this would stick out and be armor.
Periscope, yes.
Periscope.
Outside and inside the cupola. This is the famous spotlight. Spotlight and the electrical command. In his cupola, the observers on the night can look the outside with his electrical command and stay safe in his cupola.
It's a little bit like playing piano. You have to use both hands in different directions. That was for the small cupolas, with the big one as well?
The big is the original model, but okay. We don't have the material inside. It's not complete, we just have just the... The others, we do that for demonstration.
Yeah.
If it's not possible to speak by telephone, you have transmitters. Mechanical transmitters on the turret, between the free flow of the turret. When we are on the fight post of the turret, we heard the noise of the motors.
Yeah.
With machine gun, with cannon, with ventilators, more noise. You can speak. And you use this.
So, a letter, alarm?
No.
Incident?
Incident with the first weapon, incident with the second weapon, stop to fires, en batterie, we move up, move the turret up, eclipse, close.
Close.
Shoot and end of the shoot. Mechanical transmitters, here's, and electrical transmitters for the long distance. Command post to the fire rock.
So that's the same.
As in the ship.
Yeah.
We send the orders with the red arrow and arrive to the orders with the black arrow. And the bell rings. And when I receive the message, answer. I turn the red to the black, move to the alert. Message received. Light off, ring off.
So just like a battleship, that's how that would... And it is.
It's exactly the same things. And we use the French word équipage, as in the ship.
Absolutely makes sense. Perfect.
When the artillery shoots, forget the phone. In case of a problem with the telephone, if it's not possible to speak with the neighbors, there is other system.
Morse code.
Morse code, firelight, and French specialty, the pigeon.
Pigeon.
Here, this is a light mortar of 50 millimeters for observation cupola. Mm-hmm. They generally use automatic rifle, but it's possible to change and use mortars. If the enemy was high, for mortars of 50 millimeters.
Ooh.
And here's in exposition a mixed weapon. The weapon from the turret of the Block 1, not seen.
So that's the World War I turret?
Yes, but not from this one. This one comes from another place. We can go to another, demontate everything, and put here in exposition. We call this a mixed weapon, specially developed on the last fortress of the Maginot Line. The cannon and the machine gun all together. Small anti-tank cannon and left-right two machine gun model 31 with the round magazine. The place of the shooters with the scope in Z, the system for the direction and the distance, triggers for machine gun, cannon, and one shooters on the backside. Two loaders on the backside. One shooters and two loaders on the back.
And then one shooter for the cannon and one shooter for the machine gun.
Yes, it's the same.
That is impressive. Hanging up this magazine storage.
And Emily on the other floor for the soldiers to prepare basket with anti-tank cat shoot or drone and move up. This weapon was not developed for First World War, but installed in turret of First World War.
Okay.
And modified to receive another cannon. Can you imagine to build a turret like we see? Mm-hmm. Just only for two machine gun?
That's a little bit.
In the 30s, they see the Germans start the equipment of tank. That's why they redeveloped the anti-tank cannon.
It doesn't take much. This is not heavy.
No, with mechanical system or with landing, it's very easy.
That was from a really nice base.
And look at the little footprint this has.
We use the original electrical material, light and switcher. The material of this time was built to be used for a very long time. And it's possible to renovate everything.
It is.
Now you use 5 years and you drop.
And the popcorn walls really is a nice touch.
Yes.
I mean, honestly, it looks cozy.
And a lot of people have visited other places, and that's the first thing they see.
The popcorn?
Yeah. Behind these doors, there is normally storage for food with 2 months reserve for 176 men.
That's a lot of food.
And here we are nearly the barracks. The barracks, it's another gallery, 60 meters long, with a telephonic central, command post, bedroom. The telephonic central with the switchboard system.
And the original French uniform.
I will say uniforms have become more comfortable over the years.
Here's a cabin phone, only for officers, not to call girlfriends, only for secret communication. Special communication, and this telephone have no connection
to the switchboard,
to this room. It's not possible to hear for the soldiers. It's for question of rumor.
Yeah.
And against the spy. Ah. The other friend.
The other thing, yeah. That's why you don't call your girlfriend, and never mind.
The girlfriends have no telephone at this time. They have
blind. No civilian telephones?
No, many. No. We are in French. In France.
you had more cars than the Germans.
Here's two officers' bedroom, two lieutenants, and the captain. Here's the captain.
Oh, that's where you see the painting on the wall from
yes.
The bar.
Yeah. Look, this is the same of this one.
The same pattern, yeah. That's right. And the nice pink walls is a nice touch.
This is typical of the last fortress built. On the first, they use the same colors for everything, and they see moral trouble. And they change the colors. We use the colors found on the wall.
And that's what I mean. It makes sense. It's lighter. It gives a little.
In 1936, there is the first alert for the Maginot Line. First occupation when the Wehrmacht. Come back to the French borders. Mm-hmm. Before they are to stay at 200 kilometers, and they occupied the French borders in 36.
Yeah.
And this is the first alert for the first fortress of the Maginot Line built.
And that's when you yeah. Kind of figure out.
And they see this thing works, this thing not works. We need to do some things. Yeah. On the bedroom of the captain. We have this small flag with the shamrock and the turret on the middle. The shamrock and the turret on the middle was the last original part of the ROHRBACH. Each fortress had its banner. And after the armistice, after the orders of evacuation, the captain was not there during the battle with his fortress, and he don't want to give the banner at German officers.
Of course not.
He cut the banner in 176 pieces and gave one at each man and say it's perhaps a part of Lorraine where we fight if we can go back home, or a part of France if we go to Germany.
Tell me they all met and put the flag back together again.
No, not possible. The man was sent during 5 years in prisoner camp. Some of conserved, some of loose. There is peoples from east of France. And the region was taken by Germany. And this man was separated of the other prisoners and some months after incorporated on the Wehrmacht and sent on the Russian front. 130,000 men from east of France incorporated on the Wehrmacht. There is 2,000 volunteers. Here we are on the command post, the head of the fortress. That was here normally for the Lieutenant CASSO, the chief of the technicals, mechanicals.
Yeah, I love the color.
You can see the original colors here. This is the original green. Seven officers with one doctors, one chief for the observers, one for technicals, infantry, and one by rockets. On the first months of battle, there is no frontal attack against the Maginot Line. That's what the French want, finally.
Yeah.
The attack start against Belgium and Holland. This attack against Belgium and Holland was a trap.
a trap to oblige Holland and Belgium, call French and English, call help. Yeah. French and English move in Holland and move in Belgium, and the French use his mobile reserve from the Ardennes to move in Holland. They send his mobile reserve in Holland, very far, and that's where the Wehrmacht attack against the Ardennes, turn the French and the English dispositive, and afterwards surround French, English, Belge in the north, and step by step push on the direction of the beach. After the first months of battle, French lose his most modern division, and the Wehrmacht move in the direction of Paris. When Paris was occupied, the French troops in east of France have orders of evacuation covered by the Maginot Line. And the last Wehrmacht division in front of the Maginot Line start the attack against the Rhine rivers and the floating system of the Maginot Line. Step by step, they surround the Maginot Line and start the attack, generally on the backside. This type of attack on the backside works against isolated fortification without artillery supply. It's possible for the Wehrmacht to push his artillery very close to the entry and start the bombing. They try to use the same things two times in the ROHRBACH, but with the artillery protection of the Sims roof, all of this movement was blocked. In 2 weeks, the big neighbors Sims roof with his artillery shoot 30,000 shots in 2 weeks to cover his neighbors. At the armistice, inside the Maginot Line, no orders. They are surrounded. Wehrmacht officials come to speak and say, okay, now it's over. You need to leave. French say, you put your bluff on your pocket. We have munition and food. We stay inside. If you want, you come, but we stay. And they wait 1, sometimes 2 weeks after the armistice, the right orders for evacuation. With the idea for the soldiers, we are not doing the battle, we are not prisoners. We can be demobilized now and go back home. But the Nazis want a victory against the Maginot Line. And they take all the soldier prisoners and say, in the actuality, we take the Maginot Line, all the soldiers as prisoners. That's what we call propaganda.
Of course.
Today we say fake news.
So the Maginot Line was never taken, really?
Only 5 fortresses to 55 built. And when the Maginot Line was surrounded, the high command of the Wehrmacht don't want to attack. They say, no, we wait. But the Nazis want this victory for propaganda reason, and they attack. Original banner. This is the banner of the Weltschauf. The Weltschauf was the brother of the ROHRBACH at 4 kilometers. When the captain of the Weltschauf hears in pictures was taken prisoners, a German colonel come and speak with the captain and ask, where is the banner? I want the banner now. The captain say, my banner is burned and over. Banner was not burned. High on the jackets, on the back of the jackets, 5 years prisoners with the banner on the jacket, with this one, and come back in France at the end of war with his banner. After his death, his daughters give the banner at the association to put here in presentation. They give at the association because the soldiers of the Weltschauf come from the same regiment.
There's one thing that the history books never have mentioned enough, and that is the extreme pride of French officers fighting throughout World War II, even through being imprisoned or resisting or having escaped and went on to fight elsewhere. There's a lot of heroics that history seems to forget to mention. Because all history talks about when the Battle of France is, oh yeah, it went over really quickly. But it really wasn't that quick, and it wasn't that simple, and it did cost Germany some 140,000 killed,
And the Maginot Line, for the most part, still held and did not surrender or give up until the weeks after the armistice.
So this is the big bedroom?
This is a big bedroom for 26 men with hammocks. Possible to switch the hammocks, possible to put the tools inside, like the first, mm-hmm. and to have a real living place on the journey.
So they weren't hut bunking here, so somebody was not always...
Hut bunking on the block,
and here
they are 24 hours free, and yeah. they turn.
Oh yes, okay. So what would they do here every day if there were...
There is some work to do, to clean everything, and when they are here, they can write letters, play card, or some games.
That doesn't sound like work.
Yeah. The system of the hammocks was tuned for the French men of the time, not big as today. If you are too small, you can move up. Yeah? Especially if you have friends sleep here.
Yep.
If you want to move on the hammocks, there is a special technique.
Ah. I'm just telling you, I have medical training. I can put you back together.
You move up. You sit. And you slide.
Oh, yes. That makes perfect sense. So, I bet the Navy could learn something out of this.
Yes. Bedroom for the engineer's troop. Always more comfortless for the specialists of the Maginot Line.
Oh, they get little letters into their bed and everything. Oh.
More comfort, more money, and more wine every day. 1 liter by man and by day. But that was wine at 6-7%.
Okay.
Like a beer. Sergeant, bedroom. Upstairs, toilets, wash basin, and shower space.
I have to check and see if the door is airtight.
No, because here...
There's no pressure.
No, here there is no overpressure or overpressure, it's on the block.
And this is the cistern for the shower for the water?
Not for the showers, for the toilets.
That's what...
This is toilets, this is not showers.
But this is
the water tank.
Oh, see, so it's for flushing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Small doors for soldiers, sergeants, big doors for officers.
And you would stand up and take a trip?
Yes.
Which is not as uncomfortable as people think. It's really not.
And they use half doors. It's to go fast, not always the same inside. Yeah, and in case of suicide, this is the only room where you go normally alone.
Oh.
Here there is trouble, your friends can see.
Was that a problem?
We don't heard history about that.
But you may as well think about it.
There is a placard of presentation. Lot of people have no toilets at home. And this is toilets with chemical system. That's why there is presentation. And the first sentence say, using only newspapers cut with regular size, 15 to 15 centimeters.
Mm-hmm.
Wash basin and showers. This is typical of the last,
yeah.
of the last place of the Maginot Line. On the first, they use only concrete, and for the hygiene, it's not good.
No.
We call this terrazzo, and it's easy to clean, better hygiene, better living condition.
You still use that today? Yeah. And you had the water resistance underneath? Yeah. Or at this?
Same on the floor.
Yeah. Hello.
Two showers for 176, one showers on the week. But for this time, and sometimes in wartime, 1 shower on the week is a good comfort.
I know. So do they give out a lot of perfume, like in the submarines?
And I meet some German or some American veteran, and they don't have 1 shower on the week. waiting room to see the doctors.
Fair enough.
You see the lady first, and after you see the doctors.
Yeah, that's really not. That's still true today.
And here's the summary. One doctor with one man to help. There is no lady, or there is too much sick every day.
Oh, dear God, yeah. So that is to sterilize.
Yes.
Yes.
This is not for operation. This is for first wounded, for small wounded here. Operation perhaps in case of emergency, but
were there wounded here during a battle?
In the cupola of the entry, there is one observer was hit by shrapnel on the face,
and he came here.
Yeah.
Other than that, it was just VD. How much leave did the French soldiers get?
August 39, the war was declared in September, and the first can go home in November. But there is only one crew. There is only one group here. There is no relief.
So they really couldn't go.
Yeah.
Because there was no one else.
And we come back on the main gallery. Here, this is the canteen.
How appropriate.
And specially tuned for French. No comfort. In front of the wall. And you don't speak with your friends.
Really?
If you give too much comfort as French guy on the table, you stay for a minimum of 1 hour. A minimum. Like this, you heat fast and you let the place for the others.
I'm glad you said that, because if I ever said that, then I would get in trouble.
I remember doing a war movie many years ago with a very famous French actor, Olivier Gruner. Oh, did I mention your name, Olivier? I'm sorry. Who was it that wanted an egg white omelet at 3 a.m. in the middle of a muddy field, Olivier? Who was that?
And everything works.
Here's the transformers room. Normally, electricity comes from the outside. High tension arrives with the black cable behind, 17,000 volt arrive here, move to the selectors and to transformers, and change in 110 on the time for the whole electrical system.
How many volts?
17,000. To work safely, electrical specialists have material with ceramic for floor isolation, or other model with backlight.
Ooh.
Backlight and special working clothes, isolant cloak, and material in wood to stay at the distance of the material. No contact directly with the hand, but with the heart, with the hook, with the clothes, or like this. And against electrical arc or this kind of things.
Yeah, of course you have.
When the Maginot Line was surrounded by the Wehrmacht, the first things the Wehrmacht cut the electricity.
Of course.
And the engine, the generators, was stopped.
Access tunnels we're walking on for cables.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cable or pipes. And this is the electrical factory with the two generators. One is enough for all the place. Works one by one. Or if one have problem, it's possible to start the others.
Are those ship engines?
No, that was special motors for electrical production. Looks like ship engine, but it's special engine for electrical production. Here, this is the engine, and here's alternators for electrical production.
70 kVA for electrical production, 4 cylinders, 100 horses, 200 turn by minute, 600 turn by minute, very slowly. That's why they still work today.
Wow.
But not for today, because it's not possible to start only for 5 minutes.
No.
On YouTube, if you search SMIM motors, you can see this one works. SMIM to mean society, motors, industrial and mechanical. This is the well for the waters. Water is important.
Yes.
You can drink wine, but you can take showers with wine.
Well,
that's why it depends. If you have drink too much wine, yes. But the well is very important. A deep well, 220 meters deep. And with this, you have no problem. You have always something to drink, yeah. To cook, to coating material, weapon. No waters, no life.
Does all the forts have their own ground, the ones where they're...
The most majority. About the waters, I continue about the waters. Yeah. When they coating the generators, the warm waters produced with the coating system was recycling for heaters of the bedroom. And the cold waters of the heaters come back to the water tank to be reused to coating generators.
Okay. Everything was thought through.
Generators works with diesel, and there is 2 months of reserve behind the doors, 20,000 liters. 2 months for food, 2 months for electrical production.
And then you really don't want to be down here anyway. By that time you'll be out of toilet paper, in which case it's much worse.
Small mechanic area for mechanic place, yes, for some operation.
As we would say, a place to fix shit would be the technical term. You always see the beams, but you never see the hoists.
There is here the first motors, normally with here's an air compressor, actually in renovation, and using to start the biggest engine. With compressed air. Another gas alarm.
Yep.
And in this electrical factory, typical of the last construction of the Maginot Line, the same tiles as in metro station from Paris.
I thought it looked familiar.
The reason, on the first place of the Maginot Line, they used these simple white tiles. But there is no enough light. With the whole electrical system in 110, give a yellow light, and the mechanicals want more light for precise job to do. And the ingenious things, okay, in the metro they use these tiles stewed to reflect the light, and they use. And has in the metro station from Paris the name of the place. As the name of the metro station. Museum for factory of ROHRBACH. Watch the step. Gotcha. And the most important room.
The winery? The wine cellar?
The kitchen. The
I know. It's just so easy to say the wine cellar. We're in France after all.
Inside the Maginot Line, a good food. Everyday meat and fresh food. Vegetable, keep the entry stay open. Good food for the morale. To live underground without intimacy is not easy, and good food, it's always better for the end.
This is like a submarine.
Yeah. Kitchen works with coals or with oil, two system.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. It's possible to cook inside and the food stay warm, and it, you can you cook inside, you close, and afterwards you can put this on the wagon to carry on the fight block. All the men have warm food. Important for the morale too.
Very. And that's what they cook.
Friteuse.
Of course. Of course you have a prior, of course. and you had the rail for the, oh, you had to hang a little crane for it.
Coffee machine?
Most important part in anywhere. And the cold chute, of course.
Machine for peeling potatoes, bring the meats, prepare sausages, all these kind of things.
No, wait a minute. You have 175 soldiers, and you have a machine for peeling potatoes.
Yeah.
But isn't that, that's what the private soldiers are supposed to do. Okay, all right, that's it. Maginot Line, you win. I had never seen a potato peeling machine in a fort before. I wasn't sure where my vote was gonna go. It was between here and the east wall, but you win.
A room to stock the fresh meats, cold room. But we have to imagine that maybe probably a half cool or a complete cool inside, heat very fast, and after another arrived.
Yeah, because this wouldn't, this is only for a day or
yes.
Two, yeah. And then they have the big storage for, and the larder.
Here's a pantry.
Yeah.
For the kitchen material and.
And the big pots.
Yes.
And obviously a door that locks, because you want to lock the kitchen doors.
Here, this is the best place of the fortress. It's always warm, there is always something to heat, always something to drink.
I agree. I absolutely agree. This really is a little battleship. This is, okay, I've seen those bags twice now.
This is for the water transport.
Water, okay.
Yes, it's a bag. You can put this on your backpack,
yeah,
and to for the waters.
It's actually watertight. Yes. Okay.
When the French boys would have this material to take the waters of the rivers and.
Wow.
Quarter liters of wine when you heat, and a half liters every day, except for the mechanicers. For engineers, 1 liter.
And we arrive at the end of the gallery. Here's.
We are under the entry, the block 2.
Mm-hmm.
Behind here's it's engine of the elevators.
There's an elevator?
The only. Normally, there is project for elevators in each block. To carry munition, material, and food, but not installed on the other block. No money, and only one here.
And that's the original elevator.
Yes, with new electrical command and new electrical board. Yes, this is the first renovation of the association. If you have tools to carry painting and
get to the elevator,
you are very happy to have an elevator.
I am impressed. Are we taking the elevator up or are we walking?
Yes. If you want to walk, you can walk. I use elevators.
Well, I mean, if you, I'm gonna use the elevator. I don't want to be strange like that, guys.
Here's your the original. It's normally for 1,000 kilo. Yes, for 1 tons. Okay. Only used for munition material and officers. The men use the scales.
I'm not a working man. Did you hear that, General?
And during the period of the Phony War, the first French ministers come and visit in the place, and Mr. Daladier, and use the elevators.
He's not, he wasn't an officer. Damn politicians.
It's moved very slowly because it's for heavy charge. Munition kind of things.
Oh, those damn explosives.
Quietly.
Always being delicate.
So. And we are on the first floor.
This is normally entry for men, munition, material. With here's ventilation at the right place, not on the second floor.
A mixed weapon cupola, the same weapon seen on the small room. And the original was on the cupola, here on the back.
So that's the weapon in the cupola that we were sitting in?
Yeah.
That's what it looked like. So that's the same type cupola, just a different axis, because this was the steel one that was in place.
You have two type of cupola. Smallest model for observation, just 17 tons, and biggest model, 25 tons for defense. On the first construction of the Maginot Line, that was cupola only with twin machine gun, and on the second generation, little bit biggest, with this material inside.
Okay.
With one anti-tank cannon more.
Would they turn?
The cupola is fixed.
It's fixed.
But it's possible to put the weapon on the back,
and then
turn the floor, and change the position. You have different position. You don't have 360 degrees, but you have different position.
Gotcha.
And here's with the weapon.
Yeah. The traditional. Yep.
And we see the size of the soldiers.
They were shorter back then.
Yeah. Not big as today. You have right size for the Maginot Line.
If
you can move up on the turret, on the fight post of the turret, you have right size.
I have bigger boobs.
nice ball. So, and then that locks there, and then that just... You have a good fuel of fire. I mean, you don't see a lot.
No, it's only for the protection of the entry.
Yeah.
Defense short distance. And here so we can see the chute directly against the doors.
So this is the original door that they actually shot through.
When the Germans attack, they arrive on the backside with light anti-tank cannon, 37 millimeters. They start to shoot. One shoot come here to the doors.
Wow.
And the Germans arrive with some troop at 200 meters on the back and stopped by the artillery and the shoot of the cupola.
And that's return fire.
Yes.
And that's incoming. Actually, that's not bad for it's not a bad shot. I mean, I guess that's what he was aiming for.
There is normally more damage on the ceiling of the block, but for safety reason we have to repair, because there is some pieces of concrete fall to the bridge, and for visitors it's not safe.
Yeah, of course.
There is here's another munition still inside the head.
I see it. I see the casing.
The antenna for radio communication.
Well, this is
yes.
Pretty vulnerable though, wasn't it?
Yes.
But
not really used. The first communication system on the Maginot Line was a telephone. The French have no confidence on the radio.
They
are afraid to be heard on the by the German, or
at least they would have been heard by their own soldiers.
Yes.
Here. It's full of impacts on this turret here. Didn't penetrate, and apparently from those who sat inside, it wasn't a big deal. Some of these could have been from testing, but certainly some of them was from the time of the war. I am so lucky to meet so many great historians who love what they do. And they really are. It was a complete happenstance that he happened to be here and could be bothered to show me around. It's definitely worth a visit, and you will see the web address for this. Trenches surrounding it, positions, and then continues. But this leads up into the fort itself. Okay, so that's for, in case of war, they would store the mines in there and then put them out in place.
Mine storage with some tools to be ready in case
they were pre-precision, they knew where they were going to put the mines.
Yes, on the field nearly. Yeah.
To store and retrieve ammunition from here.
The association, it's 17 men. And from older generation, youngers at 19, olders the same age as the place, born in 38. And we try to preserve this place, and step by step we make some renovation with equipment and material, and visit when it's possible. We finance the renovation with the visit.
I don't think it's until now I truly understand the greatness of the Maginot Line, and that is thanks to a handful of volunteers spending their time and money to keep history alive.